He was a novelist, biographer, essayist, polemicist, campaigner for gay rights, related to both Al Gore and Jacqueline Kennedy and so on and so forth. And he spent much of his life in Italy. So Italy was his country where he lived, which he intensely loved and sometimes disliked. And he once said about Italy, he said, "Italy is a combination of capitalism and socialism and exhibits the worst features of both." And as a longtime resident of my own country and a student of its history and politics, I want to amend Gore Vidal's remark. India is a combination of capitalism, socialism, and feudalism, and often exhibits the worst features of all three. If you look at the deferential culture, the sycophancy, the nauseating sycophancy of our politics and our everyday life, that comes from feudalism. Our attacks on women, our treatment of Dalits, that comes from feudalism. If you look at the greed and the avarice and the impatience and the anger, that comes from capitalism. If you look at the paranoia, the suspicion, the tight control, and so on and so forth, that comes from socialism. But as Gore Vidal would admit, there are some redeeming features to capitalism, socialism, and indeed, in our case, feudalism. And with feudalism in particular, it's the cultivation of the arts. You know, the Maharajas and Nawabs of late colonial India were largely maligned. The nationalists detested them. You know, Gandhi was the son of a Diwan, but people like Nehru and Patel actively hated the Maharajas, partly because they were politically allied to the British. And the writings on the Maharajas and the Nawabs speak about their decadence, of course, their, in the case of the Nizam of Hyderabad, also his miserliness, for example. But they nurtured art and creativity. Indian classical music would not be alive without the Maharajas, the Nawabs, and the musicians they patronized. And it would not have been alive today had it not been sustained by socialism. So Indian classical music, which I regard as the finest flower of Indian civilization, to me, the greatest Indians alive are our classical musicians. Absolutely. Not our artists, not our entrepreneurs, and certainly not our writers, our classical musicians. And their art was sustained first by feudalism and then by socialism. Had it not been for All India Radio, the art of Hindustani music in particular, and possibly also classical music, would have been dead. You know, Ali Akbar, Ravi Shankar, Bismillah Khan, Mallikarjun Mansoor, Gangubai Hangal were all kept alive after the demise of the princely order by the state. And so also with photography, with art. First feudalism, then socialism. It is one of my peeves that capitalism has not done enough, either for music or for the arts, but I'll leave that aside. But in that sense, what you're witnessing today, and what you will witness, is the redeeming side of our not excessively lamented princely order, the enabling side of our sometimes apathetic and unfeeling state. And without the Nizam, without the government of India, I would not be here today, and I want to, in that sense, express my appreciation for feudalism and socialism, two political systems for which I do not otherwise have much sympathy. So it's a fascinating exhibition. I went around. You'll see the range of images, buildings, people, characters, contexts, you know, a portrait with sensitivity, affection, sometimes sly humor. You'll see some rather amusing photographs as well. And do please enjoy it. I'd like to end with a mere historical fact, or really a historical curiosity that struck me when I came here. I knew of Raja Diddayal. I knew about the importance of his work. I knew that when the IGNCA was started in the late 1980s, this was one of the first major collections they'd acquired. I was not privileged enough to have seen the exhibition in Delhi, but I knew about Raja Diddayal and his importance. I'd read some scholarly literature on his contributions. What did not strike me, or what perhaps I'd forgotten, was the place of his birth. And I want to say something about Sardana, the town of Sardana, Sardana is an inconspicuous small kasba on the road from Delhi, where I studied, to my hometown of Dehradun. It's just off Meerut. It has a famous church called the Church of Our Lady, which has an annual festival, which is an extraordinary syncretic event to which Hindus, Muslims, Christians, atheists, Parsis, Jains, and also probably Jains all go. Sardana has produced some extraordinary characters. Deen Dayal is only one of them. The first history book I ever read was by Ruskin Bond. It was called Strange Men, Strange Places. It was published in the late 1960s. And it was about odd, eccentric Anglo-Indian characters of the pre-British era, right, before 1857. So it had, you know, Claude Martin, the French adventurer who set up the La Martinia School. It had various German generals who had worked with the Marathas. And it had one man, whose name I temporarily forget, who was also a buccaneering European who made money, won some battles, and set himself up as the Nawab of Sardana, and married a local woman who was known as Begum Samru, and who, after her husband's death, actually ran the whole place. Now, she must have been a considerable lady, and the church was partly endowed and created by her. She gave birth to a man who moved to England. He was partly French, partly Indian, and partly God knows what else. This Indian of mixed blood moved to England, acquired the name of Dice Somber, and as it happens, was the first person of Indian extraction to sit in the British Parliament. It's commonly but mistakenly believed that Dadabhai Nauroji was the first Indian MP, the first Asian MP. I mean, Dadabhai Nauroji was elected from Finsbury in 1893. But Dice Somber, originally from Sardana, sat in the House of Commons a full 50 years before that. He is the subject of a quite interesting book, but academic and scholarly book, by an American historian called Michael Fisher, which is called, I think, The Inordinately Interesting Life of Dice Somber. So you have Begum Samru, you have her son, the first Asian MP of the House of Commons, you have Raja Deen Dayal, and finally, my dear friends, you have the great living actor Nasiruddin Shah, who also comes from Sardana. So there must be something about the air, the water, the spirits of Sardana that gave us all these people. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for that wonderful speech. On behalf of NGMA, I now present the vote of thanks. First and foremost, I send the thanks to Dr. Amin Guha, eminent historian and author, for accepting our invitation and taking the time from his busy schedule to be part of this inauguration. Thank you, sir. I also extend our gratitude to Sri Sudhakar Rao, Chairman Advisory Committee, Sri K.G. Kumar, Director, NGMA Bengaluru, Member of the Advisory Committee, Bengaluru, and Sri Vikram Sampat, Director, SRC IGNCA, and Ms. Himani Pandey, Curator, IGNCA, New Delhi. We would also like to acknowledge Ministry of Culture, Government of India, for initiating this exhibition, and finally, my colleagues and staff members at NGMA Bengaluru for installing this exhibition. Thank you all. There will now be a formal opening of the exhibition by Dr. Ramchandra Guha and a viewing of the exhibition followed by high tea at the cafeteria. I request everyone present here to join us at the gallery for the opening and the viewing. We hope you have a nice evening. Thank you very much.